वेरी क्लोज टू माई हार्ट एंड बिकॉज आई थिंक दिस टॉपिक इज़ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट बिकॉज टूडे वी आर ऑल्सो स्पीकिंग ऑन अ प्लेटफॉर्म विच इज़ रिलेटेड टू इट. वी हैव अ डिजिटल प्लेटफॉर्म थ्रू विच वी कैन इंटरेक्ट टूडे इवन इन द टाइम्स ऑफ इवन इन द टाइम्स ऑफ कोविड-19. सो माई टॉपिक टूडे इज़ अबाउट डिजिटल टेक्नोलॉजीज इज़ साइबर लॉज. सो वाई वेट, कैन आई शेयर माई स्क्रीन? टुडे द टॉपिक ऑफ माई प्रेजेंटेशन इफ द साइबर लॉ दैट इज इन प्रेजेंट इन इंडिया प्रोवाइड एडिक्वेट साइबर सिक्योरिटी टू स्टेक होल्डर्स और नॉट. As we all are aware of the growing technology, impact of technology is evidently everywhere. If you look around yourself, there is hardly anything which is left untouched by it. Like if we step out of a home, we can get ourselves an Uber and Ola, right? And if we want to get food for us, then we can order food from online through Swiggy. And even like I just mentioned that we are also communicating through our digital mode, that is Google Meet. So this is the great impact that the technology has caused. So therefore, the need for the cyber law, first of all, we need to delve into the question like why there was need for cyber law. Why do we need cyber law? First of all, the technology has brought many changes. Like it has changed our way of shopping. Today it is from paper to paperless world. Like if we are going for filing up of tax, then we can go for internet and then file up the details of a tax and fill the and do the tax thing. And then if we are communicating, we have several platforms. Today the prices also keep dropping, which has make it affordable. Earlier it was not affordable and not every person can afford to have internet connections in their homes. So and moreover, storage densities is doubling every 12 months, bandwidth is doubling. So this is only making it accessible to everyone. If it is easier to use, then every one of us will use it. Internet, as we all know, that it is expanding. Earlier it was only to very limited area, and now today if we look at even the small villages, the network reaches there. They can use internet and do anything they want with it. Like they can surf internet and watch movies or get some data about anything. Today the number of internet users is increasing with a very large scale. Earlier, it was in the year 2018, India had over 480 million internet users across the country. This figure is projected to grow over 660 million users by 2023, indicating a big market potential in internet series for our country. So, as I just mentioned, that the internet has changed our manner of communication. Earlier, the manner of communication was through letters, postcards, and now we have like various platforms like Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and many more like that. And I'm pretty sure that all of us who are present in this Google Meet, I think most of us are having our Facebook account, but the point here is that are we even sure, like before entering our data into any internet, any social media platform, that the data we enter there is secured and safe? If we make a Facebook ID today, we are not even sure that the data we are entering there is safe. If the data is getting passed on to any other commercial sector. And you would be surprised to know that in 2018, the latest in 2018, it was revealed that FB knew about massive data theft that was happening on its platform, and it actually did nothing about it. FB CEO and co-founder Mark Zuckerberg himself broke his silence on internet, and he shared this news with the followers that they knew about massive data theft that is going on their platform, and they are doing absolutely nothing about it. So this is a serious concern, and that is why we need a law which governs these areas. Today, according to the World Bank data, a day on the internet, अराउंड 4.2 बिलियन गूगल सर्चेज हैपन्स एंड 207 बिलियन ई मेल्स आर सेंड. लाइक देर इज अ लॉट ऑफ डेटा ऑन द स्क्रीन. सो दिस शोज एट हाउ वट ग्रेट एक्सटेंड द इंटरनेट हैज बीन यूज बाई पीपल. So this is a one important quote that I really find interesting by the National Research Council. I would like to share it with you, that the modern thief today can steal more with a computer than with a gun. Tomorrow's terrorist may be able to do more damage with a keyboard than with a bomb. Because with internet, we have the unlimited access. Like at one point of time, with one tap, we can reach to millions of users and can get the data that is in the systems or through any. So this is very critical thing that needs to be analyzed, and that is why the cyber law is needed. Realizing the importance of need of a cyber law, our lawmakers decided to get a law specifically related to internet, computers, and mobile devices. In the IT Act was came into the IT Act came into force in the year 2000. This is the primary legislation in India which deals with cybercrime and electronic commerce, and this is based on UN model law on electronic commerce 1996, that is UN central model. And this act originally consisted of 94 sections that is segregated into 13 chapters. So this act was formed for the primary purpose that to provide a legal recognition to electronic commerce and to provide a safe platform for the users. So there are various cyber crimes that are used by the cyber criminals to get into people's computer and gain substantial data and substantial gain from them. We can bifurcate them into three categories, that is crime against persons, crimes against property, and crime against government. First is crime against person, like as it means that this is a law, this is a crime which affects lives of actual people. And the examples of it are like cyber stalking, impersonation, loss of privacy, harassment with the use of computer, and transmission of obscene material. These type of crime affect the lives of persons. Like if a person is cyber stalking, then the kind of trauma the person, the victim gets is at different level. So this was crime against person. The another slide is about crime against property. So crime against property is related to person's property, like intellectual property. So if a crime is committed against intellectual property, then it can come under crime against property, and it can be computer vandalism, stealing secret information and data, and siphoning of funds from financial institutions. Another slide talks about the crime against government. Those crimes which are conducted to harm the sovereignty, unity, and integrity of a nation comes under this category of crime against government. Examples of this are cyber extortion, cyber terrorism, and computer viruses that can enter into government authorities' websites and steal some very important data. So who are the main players and their motives? Basically, cyber criminals, cyber terrorists, these are the main players who seeks to gain commercial, like if it is about cyber criminals, the main motive is mostly about to seek commercial gain by hacking banks or other financial institutions. Otherwise, in the case of cyber terrorists, their main motive is to get some very important data from the government's authorities and use it against a country. Now I would like to share some very alarming cybercrime statistics that I found on internet. So you will be surprised to know that the impact of cybercrime, how great the impact of cybercrime is on the economy of a nation. Like according to McPhee's economic impact of cybercrime, 7,80,000 records are lost per day. Like only in a day, 7,80,000 records are affected due to it. Over 24,000 malicious mobile apps are blocked daily. Like you and I, we are just scrolling through internet and we see some fascinating apps. We simply go and download them. Like it looks like an interesting game or a shopping website, but little did we know that these could be a malicious mobile app which is created to steal some important data or to cause some harm to us. So we have to keep in our mind before downloading any app that it could be very harmful for us, and we should be very careful about it. And in 2015, official annual cyber crime costed dollar three th around $3 trillion, and it is estimated that this will touch $6 trillion annually by 2021. Okay, and this is one of the most terrifying statistics that I found on internet, that companies take over 6 months to notice a data breach. So we can imagine that what a cyber criminal can obtain, like for over a if it gets the access to a system for over a 6 months period. More than 60% fraud originates from mobile devices. Like I said, that we all are getting more prone to we are getting more addicted. Like I should say better this, that we are getting more addicted to mobile devices instead of using laptops. We find it more easy to use mobile devices. And so, in the case of the fraudsters who use the internet to get into others' device, so more than 60% of fraud originated from them only. And in the corona time, when we all are at home, these threats have doubled as like 6 times more in the number. Because like we are at home, they are also at home, and they are getting more time to do the damage to the system. So I've just explained that why do we need cyber law, how it can be damaging to our systems, to our nation, to our companies, and why the cyber law is very important for us. And it was also enacted by the government only by realizing all of these things. But the main point of this presentation is that the cyber law, which is presently in force in India, does it provide adequate protection? So this is the main point here, that if it provide adequate protection to the stakeholders who are using internet, like you and I, who are sitting at home and surfing internet, maybe for recreational activities, for our studies purpose, or for our internship. So this is a very important point here. So I have tried to research about it and made few slides about what are the shortcomings of the laws of this law, which needs to be amended and make it a better law to provide better protection to the stakeholders. Like first of all, I noticed about phishing activities that are carried on internet. Phishing is a fraudulent attempt generally made by emails to steal a private record. You can say that fraudster might use SMS service or email, but mostly they use email service because it is more convenient today. So they mostly use an internet service inside the email. What they do is they attach an attachment which you have to open, and once you open it, they will transfer you to a valid looking website that asks for your credentials. Like it can appear like your bank website. And you might think that it is safe to enter my credentials here. So the moment you enter your credentials here and pass the data, it reaches to the fraudsters, or you can say miscreants, and they uses it against you to get the financial gains from your bank account. So one has to be very careful while opening any such links that is attached in emails. And one important thing that phishing, like as I said, how dangerous it can get. There is no specific law related to phishing in the IT, in our law. Like in the IT law, one can only link it to section 43, which talks about damage to computer system. But there is no specific law which talks about phishing. And I think that this is a very major shortcoming that is in this IT Act 2000. Another is spams. We all are aware about spams. We all have email accounts. And we know how irritating it gets. Like you might miss an important email if there are lots of spams there. And the miscreants can use these spams to get into your system. And then maybe they can hack your device or get the data from it. So this is another method they use to enter into your device. And again, like phishing, for spams also there is no specific legislation to combat this problem. So this is a problem which needs to be taken care of by the government. Another is very important, that is data protection. You must have heard it many times that how important it is today to secure our data. But the sad thing is that there is no specific legislation today. The bill that was formulated and presented in Lok Sabha is still pending. It is currently being analyzed by a joint parliamentary committee. And the IT Act 2000 also does not provide any specific provision. We can, I think, relate it to section 43A. We can take steps again, 43A, that talks about companies' failure to use reasonable security practices to protect sensitive personal data. But there are many problems in this provision only. Like section 43A talks about reasonable security practices that needs to be carried on by a company to protect sensitive personal data, but the sensitive personal data is not defined anywhere. And moreover, this section applies only to private organizations. So what about government? So government does not come under this section. So how can a individual's data be protected and against government? How can we claim it against the government by saying that this data, they are violating our data policies? So this needs to be taken care of, and I think section 43A should be amended to cover the government authorities also under this act. Next comes is cyber squatting. Cyber squatting, I don't know how many of you are aware of it. So this is something like you can take an example like if there is McDonald's or any like Domino's, and they have not made any website for their branch, for their company, and the miscreants who are sitting there to get an opportunity, they get to know about it, and then they make the data, then they make the domain name, and thereafter they ask for a very huge amount from the big companies to give their own data, to give their own domain names. Like if I am sitting here and I just get to know about the Domino's doesn't have a website, then I purchase the domain name with the name of Domino's, and then when they want to make the website, I can charge them for very hefty amounts to give them their own domain name for use. Another is cross-border cyber crimes. We all know that internet can be used by anyone. Like if I'm sitting in India, I can reach to a person sitting in America, and I can, if I want to, I can misuse their device if I get the access to it. So today the technology has not let the boundaries affect us. We can be like sitting in India and America, and if a person is sitting in America, he can contact to a person in India. So if a hacker or a miscreant is wants to get access to a device at America, he can easily get it if he knows how to do it. So there's a need for some law which includes extraterritorial jurisdiction. Because today there is lack of global cooperation, so this is misused by the hackers and miscreants to take advantage of it. Piracy is something like, I think this is all something we all must have used it, like not exactly pirated something, but watched a pirated movies. So we are actually, if we watch a movie, we are giving them an incentive to the people who are doing this thing. So there is no law which specifically talks about piracy, and this needs to come as soon as possible, so that the creators of movies and they can get the profit that they deserve. Ransomware, I think we have heard about it like 3-4 years back, about a ransomware which was quite popular. The earliest variant was developed in the late 1980s, and today also it is in force. People, what they do is they get access to your device and then they ask for a very huge amount let you get access to your own device. So means basically you are paying a huge amount to use your own device and use your own data. Today there is dearth of skilled professionals. Okay, this is a very important thing that I found here, that today the miscreants, the hackers, they are more capable, they are more techno-friendly than the professionals that are sitting at government authorities. So today we need, today the need of the hour is that some professionals needs to be skilled according to the times, and so that we can match the pace of the hackers and miscreants. According to the data given by intelligence and cyber law experts, it was found that India suffers from dismal underreporting. People don't report it because maybe the police is not very much active in taking these cases, like we have seen in major cases, also in simple cases also like murder or theft. Police is not very active in taking part of it. Same happens in cyber criminals. Another is hostility of police, like I just mentioned about it. Okay, so these were the few loopholes that I found in this act, and I have few suggestions. I've also actually said about the suggestions meanwhile, but I would like to again give a brief about it, that the new model for digital security today, the focus should be on data confidentiality, integrity and availability. We can use the artificial intelligence and machine learning to impact more and more industries and to identify these attackers swiftly. Another that I just focus on, that we need to educate people about it. We need more professionals who can deal with it more efficiently. Another is we have to be more proactive about ransomware. I just talked about it, that how ransomware causes, like how ransomware asks a user for huge money to give him the access to his own device and data. Therefore, there is need for us to be more proactive about ransomwares. Another important thing that I would like to mention here, that we can learn from USA. USA today has many laws specifically dedicated to child pornography, data communication, data privacy, electronic records and storage. So we should also learn from USA and enforce laws specifically to it. We should handle data breaches gracefully. As I said, that companies take around 6 months to notice data breaches. So they have to be more active and handle them more gracefully. Another, like I would like to conclude here with like 3 points here, that the introduction of IT Act has addressed many topics here, like data breaches. But the point here is that it lacks the implementation, due to which the miscreants and hackers use the loopholes to get into people's devices. Another is upon us as an individual. We should be aware of it, and we should be careful about not clicking any link which we get on our emails. So this is a collective responsibility from our individuals as well, and for the states as well, to amend the laws and reform it to safeguard the interest of the stakeholders. Thank you.